for you.
Sure. So we, wake up. Everybody wake up.
I'm done. This is great.
Change would you like to see happen? And it was like, well, we want a pool, and you know, we want this, and really, a young boy did put his hand up, and he said, you know, there's no teachers at yard duty. You want to have a problem? I can't find any teachers. So that really did happen, and that really just came from that carpet math discussion. And then we went through, and we thought, okay, well, you know, what could we change? We're not getting a pool. Let's be realistic. We did that sorting activity, and then the next day, and they had done some writing about it, and then we came back. And I recorded for them. The next day, I remember sitting them down, and they had issues, and they had really great issues like bullying. You know, bullying was one that came up right away. Things to do, kids being bored, wanting to go into the library. You know, why can't we go into the library, Ms. Hoyle? I don't know. Let's find out who wants to go into the library, who doesn't want to go into the library, and let's see where that takes us. So that was a little bit... you know, I didn't have a lot of control over it. It was, where are they going to take me with this? And when I was recording, I don't think you've got the slide, but I remember, so that if that was your idea about the library, that was going to be your idea. Nobody else was going to take it. So I recorded right on it, and we had that discussion that was your idea that came up with the carpet, then that was your idea that you could follow through on. And so the math really was that whole idea of coming up with good survey questions and why. Why do we survey? Why do researchers and scientists survey? And the fact that you are going to be convincing. If you want to see a change happen, then you're going to have to be convincing, which means your mathematics is going to have to be communicated clearly. It's going to have to be authentic. You're really going to have to go out and ask boys and girls on on the playground. And if they don't answer the way you don't perceive them to answer, then you're going to have to look at that and say, okay, where do I go next? And so we went through it, and then I would basically teach us. We went through the steps of it. They had sort of a graphic organizer, I remember, to help them kind of keep track. Oh, yeah, this is my question, and this is who I'm going to ask. It was grade four, so I really wanted, because I wanted to get assessment out of it. I didn't want to see it as an add-on. I wanted this to be something that I could actually use in my report cards and in their learning. And so I said a double bar graph. And so what two groups could you ask? So we did boys and girls. They did juniors and primaries. And they went off. And then they were in teams, which was great. So what I found was, for some students, this was great. They just went on their own and they did it. Others needed a lot of help and a lot of guidance along the way. But they collected their information and then presented it.
Did we let people want to do this one to start? We have this your time for two videos?
Absolutely.
Okay.
So, yeah, new types of clubs.
Grade four boys wanted sports too. And most grade four girls wanted other clubs.
And most grade five girls wanted karate club.
And did any of your data surprise you?
Well, with the sports club and me, I know lots of grade fives will want a sports club. I got 10 grade fives.
And, I was shocked that none of the girls picked board game club because I thought some kids would want to play Trouble and maybe checkers and all the other board game clubs.
I was actually shocked that grade five girls wanted a karate club.
And why?
I don't actually know that.
No, but why were you shocked about it?
Because I didn't think that they were the ones. I thought it was going to be the boys that wanted it most.
So you kind of shattered a stereotype that you had. That's great. That's great. And this way of, did you like this way of doing math?
Yeah.
How's this math class different than your regular math classes?
It's different because we were going outside at recess. And we were playing because we were
actually play while we were asking people, like, and we got to run around while we were asking people and get fresh air too.
Because the usual math room, we were just sitting at our desk doing it, not moving around the classroom much, unless we're sharpening our pencil or doing something else.
So I thought that when they did the conclusions, it was great. I mean, yes, the doing the survey and the making the graph was great, but I thought as a teacher, the most rewarding was the conclusions, looking back at their data and really seeing, did it match what we thought was going to happen? I really liked the critical thinking because what I had asked them, write this down, it was a while ago, but what I had asked them was, you know, what did you find out, like a basic description, but what are you going to do with the data now? So now you know this, what are you going to do with it, and what other questions do you have? So they had to kind of just do that further thinking, that really critical thinking, and next steps, and we'll see a couple of those.
So a second step would be going to those juniors and asking.
Just explain why it's a second step.
Right. So when they had to go back and look at their data, these two girls had a huge number of other. So they realized, this category other, we better go back and ask some more. So that was the next step. So part of it was, okay, so what are you going to do now? So
what games would be under others? What games would you like to have organized under others? So we can do another tally chart and organize that into another graph so we know what kind of games to organize under others.
And also we found,
our next step is also to go, as I said, to find out what games would go under others, and also to go to the principal and the vice principal and say, you think we could organize these games at recess to try and give kids something to do at recess who have nothing to do. So we're going to try and convince them to to actually get us to organize these games, and maybe we'll be able to sometime.
Yeah.
Like, if this succeeds, then I will be, like, the leaders, but then we get volunteers also.
Yeah, go lead the games.
Because, like,
the last line was that she said, because we're just great fours and we can't control, the kids might be raging around, so we'll have to get volunteers. We won't show any more videos.
So what happened in our class was they did, once they had all of their data together, we did have Ms. Steinhauer come in, and she sat in sort of a community type of setting, and they presented to her. And then students really did go to, they went to the staffing committee meeting, and they talked about the teachers on duty, those two boys. They were very adamant about their issue. We also went to the vice principal, and they talked about providing games at recess time. We started Right to Play, which we've been doing at George Webster for the past 8 years. They went to the librarian.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because of the graphs. So they took their graphs, they took their information, they practiced their presentations, and they really did make some change happen. So it was a really exciting moment in my teaching career to see it come together very naturally. It doesn't always work. Not every math lesson is going to be like that, but it was really an authentic experience for them through mathematics, and it really did mean a lot to them. One other thing that I've done in my classroom really quickly is just with timelines in grade 5, we've done similar things through citizenship, but also through timelines. And they have to create an open timeline of their evenings, and they have to calculate elapsed times. And that was a really nice way in my grade 5 classroom for them not only to do the mathematics, but to then share what their life was like and to create empathy between the students. I'm now teaching grade 1, 2, and it's a whole different kind of fish. So, anyways, thank you.
And just what a difference between... just to state, I mean, typically children are taught just the conventions of graphing. When I taught, it was like, label, the XY axis, but the title, I'd always have to be just throwing that. This, because Nancy Steinhauer had these graphs lining the hallways, the children didn't have to be told that. They were also very interested in the function of the graph, and you didn't have to tell them to put their title on. They wanted it to be public, and they wanted to share it. And they also then learned, by Nancy coming in and having the town hall meeting with Robin, they learned how to then give a deputation at City Hall if they had an issue.